Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to this special preview of Kaspersky Lab's threat predictions for 2017. Today, I'm pleased to present Juan Andres Guerrero-Sade, senior security expert in Kaspersky Lab's global research and analysis team. For the first part of the session, all participants will be in listen-only mode, and afterwards there will be a question and answer session. You can submit your questions at any time through the Q&A box on your screens. I would like to remind you that the predictions are under embargo until 9 a.m. GMT tomorrow. Please do not share or communicate any of the content that you are about to hear before that time. I will now hand over to Mr. Guerrero-Sade.
Thank you. Good morning, everybody. Thank you for joining us for our yearly predictions. I hope that this is entertaining for everybody and, you know, you find it actually useful. So jumping right along, for those of you that might not know me, my name is Juan Andres Guerrero-Sade. I'm part of Kaspersky's Global Research and Analysis Team. GRATE has been operational since 2008. We've got close to 50 experts now. I believe we're about 45 at this time. And we're focusing mostly on threat intelligence and research, making sure that we're on top of some of the more advanced types of attacks, sophisticated targeted attacks, financial threats, and so on. This actually means that we get to see quite a few interesting things, and it puts us in a very good position to describe the trends that we're seeing at the highest echelons of what's happening in cyber espionage and general malware. Last year, we did these predictions, and in case some of you may not have committed them to memory, we can have a bit of a refresher here. I think our record was decently good. Obviously, it's not going to be perfect, but I think we did pretty well. Last year, we emphasized the fact that we were going to see APT start to change a bit, having less emphasis in persistence and maybe greater use of commodity malware in order to hide in plain sight, which we saw both of. We also saw the expansion of ransomware to other platforms, but also within the Windows ecosystem. That's obviously done quite a great deal, and we're going to be discussing that further, of course. We had the idea that, especially seeing groups like Carbonac attacking the banks directly and the places where the money is actually kept, we expected to see more bold bank heists and greater financial threats, and we figured in our imaginations that this would go for something like the stock exchange. The truth is that the prediction came true, but it wasn't the stock exchange in the end. It was actually just the SWIFT network. So as I'm sure a lot of you have heard, the SWIFT attacks were quite a bold, interesting new attempt by attackers to go directly after the banks and directly after the money, and they've been relatively successful in this. So that's something that we will discuss further as well. We also predicted large-scale internet attacks, so attacks on the actual internet infrastructure and availability, which is something that came true not too long ago with the Mirai botnet. And, of course, the prevalence of data dumping for shame, for extortion, to try to keep companies from being operational. And, again, yet another thing we're going to continue to discuss. But I think overall it shows that our record from last year was pretty decent. And I hope that we can be anywhere as prescient with this year's predictions. So on that note, I know that there have been quite a few vendor pitches already, thinly veiled vendor pitches that, you know, pretend that these are going to be predictions, and in reality we're just trying to sell a product. Obviously, everybody's interested in promoting their technologies, as are we. We're quite excited about what we do. But more importantly, GRATE really focuses on research, and we are extremely passionate and interested in what's happening in this space and what cyber criminals and threat actors are up to, how they're advancing that space, and how what we can do to better our capabilities in order to defend from these. So I hope that this this exercise and what we do with these predictions will prove much more useful than just to try to emphasize the prevalence of our technologies, but instead to actually get an idea of what we should come to expect, what we may want to defend against, and just to have a general conceptual landscape of where things may be going. I hope that this isn't too overly technical. I'm going to try to walk everybody through some of these things, but I hope that we can keep them interesting. So, jumping right along, as the title suggested, you know, we were being quite reckless, and we said, you know, IOCs are dead. For those of you that don't know what IOCs are, these are indicators of compromise. It's essentially the industry standard by which we can discuss known attacks. It can be something as simple as saying, you know, this particular attacker or this particular type of malware is going to use a specific file name, it's going to drop something in a specific folder, it's going to contact a specific server. And with these IOCs, other defenders can take these and turn them into measures in order to make sure that their own networks are not infected, that their own companies aren't already under attack, and to be able to watch out for known threats. As I said, this is the industry standard for now, but sadly, we've gotten to a point where attackers have caught on to this, and we've started to see what we call bespoke attacks, or essentially something like what we saw with Project Soron this year, which I think is perhaps the most interesting operation that we've seen this year, maybe for quite some time. But what we're discussing is a platform that is adapted to every single victim and every single target. You change every file name, every timestamp, and essentially make the indicators of compromise useless when it comes to trying to generalize that information in order for other companies to be able to defend themselves against the same known threat. We expect to see a greater rise of this for sure with these sort of bespoke malware. And I hope to emphasize it's not that there is absolutely no measuring, no defense, but rather that this should really signal the need to start moving towards something like YARA rules, which we're very big fans of, which would allow more practice sort of scanning and an ability to find these things, even if they don't follow the most superficial patterns. So we'll discuss some of those security measures, more proactive measures later. But continuing on this notion of, you know, what's going to happen with APTs, we also expect to see the rise of what could be called passive implants. And this is something that we also saw with Project Soron, and we expect to see a whole lot more of. Passive implants are essentially the tool of choice for cyber espionage actors who are very interested in not arousing suspicion, but need to be able to get into a network on a moment's notice. So what a passive implant does is it can sit on a gateway or some kind of internet-facing server, and it doesn't do absolutely anything until some magic bites or some kind of stimulus from the attackers from the outside wakes up its functionalities. So this is actually a great way to not arouse suspicion of defenders, and they're very unlikely to be caught unless it's in the middle of some greater incident response or some extremely paranoid defender just so happens to get lucky. Moving on, while we're in the subject of sort of memory resident and interesting espionage malware, we also expect to see the rise of ephemeral infections. The truth is that a lot of these toolkits that are being used by espionage actors, they're expensive, they take a lot of resources to develop, and I'm sure that it's not very fun for them for these to get burned or lost every time that researchers like ourselves stumble upon them. So we expect to see something like what's already happening with PowerShell malware, where attackers have actually found that PowerShell scripting, what was supposed to be a really good tool for administrators, is actually really good for them as well. So they know that they can hide a little PowerShell script, make sure that it's just running in memory or hide it in a registry key, and be able to conduct some of their operations, and it's very unlikely to get logged, very unlikely to be seen by defenders. We expect that a further expansion of this will be something like memory resident malware that only exists in memory that maybe gets injected into the system and is perfectly fine going away the moment somebody restarts the machine and all of the memory gets wiped. The idea is that this is likely to be the next step in reconnaissance malware, and the sort of malware that's just there to collect some credentials, collect some information, maybe understand a little bit more about the target, but is more than happy to get wiped away the next time the computer gets turned off or just as soon as it's done with its operations. And that means that it's very unlikely to ever be caught by researchers, it's very unlikely to ever be noticed. Next, I want to emphasize the idea of mobile malware, which obviously we all know about mobile malware. There are plenty of examples of it, and we definitely know about some high-end threat actors that have included mobile malware in their general campaigns. But we've yet to see an APT or a cyber espionage actor that is exclusively dedicated to mobile, which is quite interesting because if you consider what's happening with the digital lives of most users, there's a decreased enthusiasm in desktop platforms and an almost ubiquitous adoption of the mobile platform as essentially the point of convergence of everybody's digital life. So as a lot more of this value, this information, this availability shifts to mobile, it's going to become increasingly useful and increasingly important for some of these threat actors to make sure that they've got not just a presence there, but perhaps to start to consider campaigns that are exclusively focused on mobile. So we've seen actors like Sophocy, Red October, and obviously Hacking Team customers using mobile malware, but we expect to see perhaps the first truly all-mobile or mobile-focused espionage operation. Moving on, this has been a really interesting year, as I'm sure all of you have noticed. There's been quite a bit of intrigue, quite a bit of the role of cyber expanding in different spaces, particularly when it comes to geopolitics and some international relations, which, you know, can be quite interesting. As this goes along and as there's a certain rise in the general notion of retaliation, of political overtures, and these things become a sort of de facto part of how you deal with notorious cyber attacks, I think we're also going to see a certain adaptation in how threat actors respond to this, how they manage their operations in order to counteract this, in order to take advantage of it. And there's some things that I think that we should be particularly interested in, like difficulties of attribution, but also some of the following trends. So for those of you that may have seen, Brian Bartholomew and I released the paper at Virus Bulletin this year about a month ago on false flags. False flags are something that are particularly interesting for us since we tend to be very careful, very respectful of maintaining our position as an attribution agnostic team. And that is because there are very serious concerns when it comes to attribution and the ability to accurately figure out who's behind an attack. This is only going to get more complicated, and that's something that we expect to see in 2017. It's only going to get more complicated as some of these political overtures become a de facto part of how you handle a notorious cyber attack. So first, we expect that, you know, maybe we'll actually get to see a true false flag operation. If you read our paper, we pointed out a lot of examples where we see threat actors trying to be confusing or trying to deliberately manipulate the defenders, but they're not necessarily full-on false flag operations where, you know, you actually take on every trait and the toolkit and whatever you need in order to really cast the blame on a different actor. So we expect that maybe we'll actually see some of this, but even if we don't, there are other parts in misdirection and manipulation tactics that we think might start to become possible avenues or investments for some of these actors. One of them, perhaps the most worrisome and the trump card for some of these better known actors would actually be to dump their infrastructure or to dump the source code for their proprietary toolkits for the use of the general public. So right now, a lot of what is used to tie in known attackers to new incidents is to say, hey, we recognize this malware, or we recognize some of this infrastructure, some of these command and control servers, as something that is exclusively used by this one attacker. If they actually feel that it's worth the investment and go out and let go of the source code of one of these toolkits, it will cause a certain amount of mayhem and inability, at least for some time, to essentially tell them apart. Another way of doing this is just to increase the use of something like open source and commercial malware. This is something that some actors already use. I think that as some of the deterrence starts to enter the space and some of the retaliation becomes a little more pronounced, we'll definitely start to see things like Metasploit and Cobalt Strike and tools that are generally commercial and available to a great deal of people, perhaps being co-opted by some of the higher-end actors just to have some plausible deniability. Another thing that has been quite prevalent over the past few months and of a lot of interest to us, also detailed in the paper, is the notion of sort of perhaps informational warfare, more importantly, the notion of being able to dump information to shame companies, dump information to shame individuals, essentially being able to manipulate information flow in the hopes of changing an outcome or disparaging an entity. This is something that we've been seeing more pronounced since perhaps the end of 2015, definitely quite interesting with things like the Hacking Team trove that came out. I think the one trend that we'd like to emphasize is as some of these actors find it valuable to come up with false fronts, things like hacktivist collectives or pretending that they're part of Anonymous, even though in reality it's well-established threat actors, we also find it interesting that we're at an all-time high concern for the possibility of manipulating some of this data. So, of course, it's one thing to dump an entire mail spool for a certain organization, but there's nothing to say that this hasn't been tampered, that the information hasn't been omitted or manipulated, and it'll be curious to see the increase in these sorts of deception tactics for a public that's quite interested and quite open to having information dumped on them. In the same way, we expect perhaps the greater rise of the vigilante hacker. I mentioned the Hacking Team trove that got released last year. This was done by someone that goes under the name of Phineas Fisher. And quite interestingly, a few months after the Hacking Team trove came out, he actually released a guide for other aspiring hackers to be able to serve their brand of social justice on companies that they consider to be doing anything illegal or acting in inappropriate ways. I think it's the right conditions and interesting conditions for people to try to take matters into their own hands for better and worse. So we expect to see a great deal more of this. Moving on to something perhaps more interesting to some of you would be the notion of financial attacks. For those of you that have been covering the SWIFT attacks, this has been incredibly interesting and an interesting development as far as financial malware goes, but it's definitely not the end of the line. At this time, you're just seeing a few actors. It takes several different elements to be able to pull off one of these attacks. One of them, non-trivial one, being having some sort of specialized malware or very specific toolkit to be able to pull off the SWIFT attack itself. And then, of course, you're going to need things like being able to launder the money, knowing where to send it, and so on. It's been the case with a lot of different types of financial attacks that different stratified schemes will appear in the underground, where different criminals will provide specific services. So there will be somebody who's going to design the malware, somebody who's going to deploy it, somebody who's going to launder the money. And these turn into as-a-service schemes or things that are being sold separately in order for anybody to be able to put together their own type of attack. In this year, we expect that, you know, as more attackers become interested in the notion of being able to pull off a SWIFT heist, that we'll start to see the rise of SWIFT middlemen, people that are writing the kind of malware that you would expect for a SWIFT heist or that are providing as-a-service schemes in order to be able to pull these things off. Also, last year we discussed the rise of payment systems, things like Apple Pay, Android Pay, they're becoming increasingly popular and obviously very good, very well adopted. We have to admit, it's been nice to see how well implemented some of these payment systems have been. So they've actually proven very resilient to the kind of attacks that one might have expected. That's not to say that attackers are not going to be interested in them, but we expect the focus of their attacks to shift. If the endpoint side of these payment systems hasn't proven malleable or pliable for their types of attacks, we actually expect to see perhaps some of the emphasis shift to the actual infrastructure that manages these payment systems or that provides the ability to use them. This might prove a bit of a headache for those that are actually providing services, and it may very well be the kind of attacks on that infrastructure that are financially motivated or maybe just should, for the sake of disrupting these services. So we expect to see a little bit more of this. Now, one of the favorite topics for everybody covering security right now is the terrible rise of ransomware. This has not been fun for anybody. It's definitely quite a worrisome trend, and there's a lot of interesting things to discuss when it comes to ransomware. But one of the most salient features, and one that I'd really like to emphasize, is actually the trust relationship. Ransomware has introduced a very interesting situation where victims have to trust their attackers, and a lot of victims have actually proven that they're willing to trust their attackers when it comes to getting what they need. So there is an implicit agreement between the attacker and the victim that says, you know, once you pay your ransom, we will provide you with your files. As unlikely as this sort of agreement might seem, it's essentially what all ransomware is built upon, and there's a certain amount of confidence that has to go into that. Otherwise, obviously, victims wouldn't bother trying to pay the ransom, and they would just declare this a sabotage attack. Now, as ransomware becomes more popular, there is a concern that we might start to see what you might consider script kiddie ransomware, or essentially very low-end cyber criminals or aspiring cyber criminals who don't have the skills or the know-how to actually write ransomware to get it working, will still try to put things out there, will still try to run some of these campaigns, and will essentially swindle victims into paying ransoms even when they're incapable of recovering the files, when maybe they just deleted the files or they just locked away some of the access. So we actually foresee a sort of crisis of confidence occurring with ransomware where while some very known strains may very well inspire the kind of confidence that you might require to go ahead with the transaction, that it won't be a given and it might be an issue for that space to figure out how to manage the fact that, you know, we don't know that paying the ransom is actually going to provide users with anything that they need. Moving on to IoT, I mentioned the Mirai botnet earlier. This has been kind of a very foretold disaster for quite some time. So Internet of Things devices, for the most part, have very low security standards. They don't really have much of a concern, and it's actually not a very standardized space, which makes it very hard to secure as a whole. Now, what's interesting about these things is we're starting to actually see the detrimental effects of having quite so many vulnerable devices out there. Some of the internet outages, as you may have noticed, can be attributed to the ability to turn a lot of these devices into these massive, massive botnets. Now, the interesting trend here is there's a lot of people that are very concerned with how to make manufacturers of the devices start to care about the fact that their devices, the security sucks on them. And I think it's very likely that as these botnets become more of a nuisance, as they start to, you know, increase the amount of spam that goes out there, if they start to increase the, extremely powerful denial of service attacks that are being put through them, it wouldn't be much of a leap to see vigilantes go ahead and maybe consider hacking some of these devices themselves for the sake of bricking them. So using the same vulnerabilities that allowed some of the devices to become part of the botnets in order to damage them to the point where they can't be used, and essentially give this headache back to the manufacturers as you know, most of the buyers will be quite upset that their toaster has suddenly not only stopped being part of a botnet, but also stopped making bread. Another interesting possibility is the notion of industrial attacks. I really want to stay far away from being alarmist when it comes to this. From the moment that Stuxnet came out and it became known, the notion of an industrial attack has become a lot less science fiction and a lot more plausible to some, perhaps too plausible to some people. The truth is that Stuxnet was an extremely well-designed, very carefully designed attack that was meant to work only on specific systems and had a great deal of checks on it, which is why even though it spread to a great deal of places, it didn't cause a general industrial mayhem. That said, it showcases some of what can be done in the space of, you know, in cyberspace and some of these malicious threats when there's the right kind of intentions and capabilities. The truth is that a lot of these devices, a lot of industrial plants and a lot of industrial devices are actually online. A lot of them are not very well protected. That's not to say that a random, 14-year-old can just go in and cause a major incident, but it means that all of the right elements are in place, that as geopolitical tensions rise and as the intentions are in the right place, when they actually come around to seeing some of these unfortunate attacks. finally, I wanted to discuss the notion of ad networks. So this may seem like we're ending kind of on a lighter note, but we want to discuss something quite interesting when it comes to ad networks. The truth is that high-end espionage actors are, they would be more than happy to do purely tailored, purely targeted threats. Sometimes it's just not the nature of the space that you can do that. Sometimes, you know, the attackers feel the need to blanket an entire region or at certain types of users in order to try to find the people that they need. But that's not to say that there aren't technologies out there that could better enable their targeting. So one thing that we want to discuss is the possibility of an all-espionage ad network or an espionage-funded network, specifically because the technologies that are involved in ad networks are actually perfect for cyber espionage actors. They actually allow an unrivaled level of profiling and tracking of users, being able to profile their browsers, their browsing history, and a lot of the particularities about the systems. And you know, for an attacker, it means that you can know specifically who you're targeting and only provide your payloads to that specific victim. So that's actually a very interesting sort of capability, and we believe that it may actually prove a worthwhile investment for some of these attackers. So it's something that we would foresee in the near future to perhaps encounter an espionage-motivated ad network. Another such kind of bold move might very well be to go after some of the social networks for a treasure trove of personally identifying information, and of course to maybe target some of these anonymizing tools for the sake of being able to better track the dissidents and targets and activists. But as far as all of those are concerned, it may be the ad networks that are the most interesting as far as developments go for the coming year. So hopefully not to leave everybody in a state of despair, hopelessness about what we can do in cybersecurity and in this space, there are some recommendations for the industry, for businesses, for individuals, for everybody to feel that they, you know, they can better protect themselves and they can have a sense of where to move forward from this. It's all not, you know, it's not all cloudy days. It's not all complete helplessness and inability to move forward. For the security industry, there are some very important considerations. We definitely want to emphasize the need to move away from pure reliance on indicators of compromise and IOCs. I think it's important that people start to understand the power and necessity to adopt YARA rules, the ability to deploy these across the network, to be able to scan for specific fragments and for known traits, rather than just specific indicators of compromise. This can be quite an interesting move for the industry, and it's one that we already try to provide our customers with the ability to identify some of these threats through YARA rules. As well, we'd like to emphasize the importance of advanced and sophisticated heuristic technologies. This is something that we've been working on for the past decade. It's a component of our products that we're particularly proud of. System Watcher is our heuristic component. It's actually incredibly, you know, it's proven incredibly good against ransomware itself, but also it should provide us with the ability to handle things like the ephemeral infections that we discussed, and perhaps some of the more memory resident and specific types of malware can be quite interesting. Another emphasis for GREAT is to essentially emphasize the importance of analysts, of having humans doing threat intelligence, being able to provide a context, being able to analyze anomalies and things that are out of place. Machine learning can be important. Obviously, it's the sort of thing that you bake into your technologies, and a lot of different vendors are trying to emphasize this is the end-all, be-all of threats. But the truth is that no matter how good your technologies, you need just as good analysts behind them, making sure that they understand the threats, that they know where things are going, they know where the technologies need to adapt, and what some of the intentions behind some of the attacks may be in order to better understand who it is that we're dealing with on the other side of the screen. Similarly, I mean, I think for business, we're going to be in a very similar situation to being able to hopefully adapt some of these YARA rules to adopt their use throughout an enterprise. At the same time, it would be really important to emphasize, as everybody does, the notion of automated patching, of making sure that you're not vulnerable to already known threats, but more importantly, to also train staff and to be able to increase a certain level of cybersecurity awareness. We love discussing some of the more advanced attackers. We're obviously fascinated by some of the most sophisticated measures and means that are used in order to attack different companies and individuals. But at the end of the day, we have to admit that there's also a lot of attackers that are just relying on some of the most basic types of social engineering, of spear phishing techniques, of just sending an email with the most ridiculous-looking attachment, and sadly, there's always somebody that will click on it. There's always somebody that will turn on macros when they shouldn't or open a file that's just got a double extension on it. And that's enough. That's enough for an attacker to establish a foothold. So we really can't emphasize enough how useful it can be to make sure to educate staff and to make sure that everybody has a sense of what some of these threats might look like. And finally, for individuals, obviously updating, patching, and a lot of things that we've discussed are quite important. I don't think I'm going to emphasize our rules for individuals themselves unless they're on the nerdier side of things with the rest of us. But there are some very interesting practices and important practices that we really can't emphasize enough. Obviously, we want you to have a robust anti-malware solution that can take care of some of the things that you can't foresee for yourself. For example, things like ransomware or anything to do with exploits is simply beyond, in some ways, beyond the purview of what most users can take care of. But then there's also good practices like making sure to always back up important sensitive information and make sure that those backups are actually stored offline, that they're not connected to the machines so that they're not lost in the case of a ransomware attack, for example. And also the use of strong passwords. And I would emphasize not just strong passwords, but ideally randomized passwords. There are password management solutions out there. We include password management solutions in some of our products as well. These allow you to create random passwords for every single account and to make sure that you don't need to remember them, that this software can actually manage it for you. And there's a lot of emphasis to be placed on this along with two-factor authentication to actually mitigate a lot of the more notorious attacks and breaches that we have heard about in the past few months. So while it sounds really simple, it could actually take a whole swath of issues off your plate, and it can't be emphasized enough. Especially for individuals, but also perhaps for executives and some people that could have really benefited from this sort of advice. So on that note, I hope we have kind of a general sense of some of our predictions for this year. I kind of tried to make sure that we can all walk along on this and understand some of the particularities, some of the issues. I'm hoping that it will be clear with some of the text that will also get published. We, you know, try to make sure that everybody can follow along, but we'll be more than happy to address some of the questions now for anybody that might be. You give me a minute. Let's see some of what we've got. Again, please, anybody who's got any questions, make sure to submit them through the system. In the meantime, I see we've already got a few here. All right. Let's see. If cyber criminals are getting better at hiding their tracks and blaming others, how will we ever be able to determine who's behind an attack, and what will we need to do or do differently? Well, this is some of the – honestly, I'm starting with one of the more complicated questions in threat intelligence, and something that keeps us up at night a great deal. Attribution is a very complicated issue. That's not an evasion, but, you know, for those of you that might go through it and read the paper that Brian and I published last month, you might understand the kind of technical means that go into performing attribution. So usually it's a combination of art and luck and operator mistakes that allow a company or anybody in the private sector to say, you know, we have a general idea of who this might be. And the truth is that all of those indicators are quite fungible. They're manipulatable, and it happens all the time. You know, the timestamps that one might use to understand when malware was compiled will get changed. They'll get manipulated by the attackers. They'll use stolen digital certificates. They'll use infrastructure that they hacked for somebody else. The truth is that it's not quite so simple. While everybody would love to know who is behind an attack, It may very well be beyond the abilities of the private space and the private sector to do this efficiently, and it might be better off in the hands of law enforcement and some of the signals intelligence agencies that are also concerned with these questions. So it's actually not a straightforward answer to provide. That said, from the perspective of defenders, I really don't think that we should quite emphasize who is behind an attack quite so much. I can understand why that's valuable as far as a story goes. We want to be able to say, you know, this is the attacker and this is why they did it. But from the perspective of defenders and those that are interested in making sure that they're maintaining the integrity of a network or an enterprise, the truth is that the biggest measure, the most important thing to do is, of course, to return the system integrity and make sure that the attackers no longer have a foothold and a capability within that network. So there's actually a certain amount of prioritizing that goes along for those that are responsible over an institution to make sure that they've essentially eliminated the foothold for the attackers. And attribution actually does not play a very big role in that. Let's see, other questions? Interesting one. Is the DNS server architecture becoming a single point of failure for many organizations? If so, what can be done to make DNS servers more resilient? This is an interesting one. The truth is DNS architecture has been known to be quite vulnerable in a lot of ways, a hack that was originally put together to overcome certain difficulties when the internet was being born that has essentially grown to be a staple of something that's essentially the backbone of the internet in many ways, to be able to know exactly where we need to be routing our information, where we need to be getting the resources that we're looking for from. So obviously DNS is incredibly important. That said, as the attacks, like the Mirai botnet attacks have recently shown, it is a sort of infrastructure that provides a single point of failure for a great deal of segments of the internet. It's not going to take all of it down at any given time, but if you take one of the dynamic DNS providers down for a certain few hours, there are whole parts of the internet and major services that go down with them. There have been proposals for things like DNS security that a lot of people are very invested in. The truth is that there are entire parts of the infrastructure that make up the internet that really do need a certain amount of redesign, and there really are no simple answers as far as adoption goes. So while a lot of those standards are being proposed or being pushed forward, and there's a certain amount of hopes that better solutions like DNSSEC will be adopted, for the time being, it's such a decentralized issue that it's unlikely to be changed at a larger scale. As far as companies go, you know, if you do have an organization or an enterprise, it may very well be good to have a certain redundancies as far as your own DNS servers or, you know, being able to provide that resolution internally. But the internet is about connecting devices, and the truth is that we can't fully insulate ourselves from the sort of things that make up its very backbone. So it's a mixed bag. Okay, question about threat intelligence services. So what are the main features of different threat intelligence services to be considered, and what should be considered to select the best? Well, I'm going to have an obvious bias here. Obviously, I'm very interested have a certain proclivity for our own threat intelligence service, which I work on maintaining, and my team is put forward here at Kaspersky Lab. The truth is that threat intelligence is mostly about providing context. This is something that we really try to emphasize to some of the more seasoned incident response people and IT people that are interested in knowing why they need threat intelligence at all. I mean, threat intelligence is something relatively new. Not everybody necessarily understands why it's important, but the truth is that it provides a certain context that becomes important once you're dealing with more cunning attackers, and it also provides a certain context that's important when an institution, by its very nature, by the very position that it inhabits in a certain industrial space or in a certain enterprise space, becomes the recurring target of attacks. So usually what we hear about is, this solution, this anti-malware solution or this particular security product stopped this one attack. The truth is that when you're working for an enterprise or some, for example, somebody that works in a defense sector or manufacturing, you're not getting hit with one attack, and you're not going to be hit once by one attacker. You're getting hit all of the time. So it becomes a lot more important to understand who the threat actors are, how they operate, why they're going after this particular enterprise or this particular sector, and what their behaviors are so that defenders can more proactively defend against these. So to better address that question, to say, you know, what are some of the better indicators, I think proactive knowledge is quite important. I think it's quite easy for threat intelligence services to get caught up in the run-of-the-mill small report production that essentially lets C-suite and executives know, oh, here's this trendy thing that's happening. And that'll be like a one- or two-page report with not a lot of actionable information in it. The truth is that threat intelligence needs to be actionable. It needs to include YARA rules. It needs to include indicators of compromise insofar as they're useful. And more importantly, it needs to provide an understanding of how attackers are operating. In order to better educate and better embolden some of these defenders to be able to protect themselves from some of these more advanced threats. So I think actionable intelligence is perhaps the greatest measure of what makes a good threat intel service. Let me see some of these other questions. Let's see. Oh, here's an interesting one. Are you collecting threat intelligence only via technology, or do you perhaps also have human sources? Let's see. Sorry, I'm just reading out loud it here. I'm genuinely interested if actual bad guys are involved. All right. We are not using any human sources. I know that there are some threat intelligence services that find it valuable to have human intelligence or have sources on the ground that provide them with information. I can see how that can be useful under certain models that take espionage to be sort of an adversary issue, or they want to position themselves in a geopolitically significant context. We take a very different approach. We're obviously very interested on the side that is cyber, that is malware components and how campaigns are actually being run. And I think that there's a very important distinction to be made there. Obviously, espionage can seem incredibly sexy when it involves spies and it involves the sources on the ground and agents and moles and people that are well positioned to give you insider information nobody should have. But the truth is that, you know, we're an anti-malware company, and we're most focused on making sure that we protect the integrity of the systems that we've been entrusted with and from the users of our products that are quite interested in just maintaining the integrity of what they do. These people just want to make sure that when they come to their companies that the systems are functioning the way that they should, that their businesses haven't come to a grinding halt because somebody decided that today was the day that they were going to disrupt their operations. So we really like to focus on the malware side of things. We deep dive into how these campaigns are functioning, into understanding what exploits are being used, into cooperating with a lot of the vendors to make sure that they get patched as quickly as possible. This year, we've actually had a great track record of providing Adobe and Microsoft and other companies with some zero-day exploits that have been used in the wild. These have been the results of some new technology that we have put in place specifically to catch these zero-day exploits that have been giving incredible results. So that's more of our focus. It's not to disparage anybody that's interested in humans, but I think that it reshapes some of the understanding of what's happening here, and it's not necessarily our place to focus on that when we have something that we can genuinely help users with, which is defending against the malware and the components. Okay, let's see some of the other questions. Let's see, this might be a tricky one. What do you think about politicians and their responsibility about how they use not secure servers, et cetera? For example, home servers and Hillary Clinton did a few years ago, and the same with elder seniors who make important decisions about their life. Okay, so that's two questions right there. Let me parse those out so that I don't insult politicians or seniors in the same breath. As far as responsibility of politicians, I take it the same way that I take the responsibility of executives. The truth is that there are different specializations in life. As much as we would love for everybody to be cybersecurity aware and to have cybersecurity on the forefront of their minds at all times, you really can't expect career politicians or career executives to be concerned about the configurations of their servers, how they're managing their own infrastructure. I think rightly so, they hire the sort of people that should be managing these things for them. Now, there's something to be said there about the talent gap in cybersecurity. There's not as many of us working in this space as we would like. There's not as much of proper education out there to actually produce as many cybersecurity-minded folks as we need. This isn't a space where we snipe each other. We actually genuinely welcome as many practitioners as we can because there's just not enough of us. So I do have a certain amount of sympathy for politicians and executives who are not being properly advised about some of the cybersecurity issues. But it's really important to understand that stratification and to say that there's a difficulty there with casting blame specifically on the more public figures of this when it's more of an issue with how cybersecurity is being adopted and pushed out to entire industries, how approachable some of these security concerns are. There are security measures that are quite simple for us that are extremely difficult to explain to some of the older folks out there, some of the people that are not as computer literate. And as a security space, we need to make sure that we're making this as approachable and as easy as possible. You mentioned servers specifically. The truth is that some of the better measures, honestly, are to push a lot of this responsibility onto companies that are a lot more capable of it. And at the same time, that means that you're giving another company purview over some of your more sensitive information and some of your details. So there are certain trade-offs there that I expect to be quite complicated for politicians and other executives to navigate, and they're not easy answers. So I have a certain amount of sympathy there. In the same way, I think that when we're discussing seniors, it's one of the most difficult and indignant positions for some of us in the anti-malware space, specifically because you want them to enjoy some of the modern benefits. You want them to make sure that, you know, they can do their online bank and that they can be comfortable using their machines. But we also see how much malware can take advantage of their, you know, computer literacy and some of this online banking issues. And it's something that's been happening with banking trojans for a long time, where you get the proverbial, you know, grandmother whose account has been completely wiped out because of some of this, some of the more nefarious actors that are out there, some of the more indiscriminate actors that are out there in the financial space. As far as detecting seniors, honestly, depending on how computer literate they are, the best thing to do, the same as with children, is to automate a lot of these security measures. So, you know, operating systems are getting better about making sure that there's automatic patching. There's a lot of, you know, anti-malware solutions like our own that are very focused on making sure that once things are configured, that they are just going to run in such a way as to not be intrusive to these people. And that's the best thing that we can do is to make sure that we're baking the security into the solutions and not requiring users to perhaps go out of their comfort zone and attempt to do some of the defending themselves. That's not their job. It's essentially ours. Let me see some of these other questions. Oh, here's an interesting one. This is one that I'm particularly passionate about. Somebody's asking, what about Mac malware in 2017? In the near future in general, will it increase? This is a really interesting question for me. I'm personally quite passionate about the idea of security on Mac. I'm a Mac user and always very interested in what's happening in that space. Obviously, the notion that there is no Mac malware is quite inaccurate. There's always been Mac malware. It's been on the rise in its own way. But, of course, the security of OS X and some of the measures that are more prevalent there have actually kept a great deal of the spread down. We tend to focus our security solutions on making sure kind of protect the space as well. But as far as our research goes, we see quite interesting things. I mean, a lot of the more advanced attackers have their own tools and their own malware to hit OS X. And the truth is that as a lot of users start to adopt more Mac devices, a lot of users buy their MacBooks and perhaps ditch Windows altogether, of course this is going to become increasingly interesting to some of these threat actors. Now, I would emphasize the fact that the cost of attack for some of the Apple ecosystem is increasingly higher in some ways. It means that you're unlikely to see some of the rampant spread of more trivial malware. So for example, this year, there was actually a bit of ransomware that got put out for OS X. And what's interesting is it followed the sort of trend that we tend to see with OS X malware, which is you need to trick the user in some way. You need to adopt some kind of benevolent face in order to be able to execute on OS X. But obviously, once you do, you're through the door. So what these guys did was hack a provider of common software, I believe torrenting software, and then essentially Trojanize that application. So that's one of those situations where you can see where the frailties and the weaknesses in the Mac ecosystem are, which is you just have to convince somebody that something is benevolent, and they will disable all of the security measures themselves in order to get that software running. So it's a very interesting space to research. There's definitely going to be a lot more Mac malware going forward, but it's not straightforward. There's a lot of deception and subterfuge that goes into it, and a lot of money that goes into some of the exploit development. So definitely something to watch out for. And I think we might have time for one last question here. Let's see. Let me pick a good one. Oh, okay. So here's a question about artificial intelligence. There's a lot of talk about the use of AI technology in security. How do you think such technologies will change the landscape for threats and protection in the next year? Man. Okay, so I'll be honest. I picked a question that I find kind of particularly contentious in some ways. We have quite a few disagreements in the anti-malware industry about what constitutes actual AI and machine learning and what some of these tools mean and how new some of these actually are and how much of it is just vendor hype and the sort of marketing that everybody does in order to try to get their products ahead over anybody else's. The truth is that, of course, advancements in machine learning are being put forward. They're being applied to different products. These can be quite interesting because you do, in some ways, if you consider the way the machine learning actually works, you can train systems to identify common behaviors of malware and hopefully to proactively block these. Now, the true issues come when you start to discuss what happens with false positives, which is something that the anti-malware industry is very used to dealing with. This sort of thing happens. We're oversellers trying to protect our users. Some things we rush to try to make sure that we're protecting them in the best way, that we're proactive. And every once in a while, we are going to catch something that we shouldn't. We're going to block something that we shouldn't. And we need to backpedal. We need to make sure that, you know, we correct those mistakes and that our protection is as accurate as possible. So the issue with a lot of this machine learning and AI is that it doesn't actually emphasize the importance of having seasoned experts and people that genuinely understand what's happening at the low levels, what's happening with a lot of genuine malware practices, to know when and where this malware is operating, how it operates, where it's going to go, and not just how to detect things that you've seen 1,000 times. Our anti-malware solutions, just like a lot of other anti-malware solutions, are of course going to catch the sort of really trivial malware that everybody sees all the time. If, you know, you see ransomware jumping around everywhere, banking trojans, and a lot of the sort of more trivial malware that's just been on the internet for ages and that gets developed by people that just want to make some pennies. The really interesting question is, how good are you at noticing when something is off, of realizing when there's some entirely new threat that nobody has seen before? And how quickly can you adapt to understand it, to provide coverage for your users, and ideally to better the ecosystem in such a way where you disable an entire class of attacks or you make it extremely difficult or extremely costly for attackers to go after users in a certain way? So obviously there's a certain dream in the notion of AI that it's going to take our problems out of our hands and it's going to solve them by themselves. But I really don't think that that's going to be a solution in this space. I think that genuine expertise and a lot of interest and a lot of passion is actually what's going to get us further ahead and hopefully develop the anti-malware solutions, not just of this year, but of the coming 10 years and to better this space for everybody. So hopefully that's an uplifting note for everybody to end on. I hope that some of these predictions prove useful. Of course, I would like to be wrong in a great deal of them, and for all of us to just be safe. And at least I can promise that we're going to be doing as much as we can to make sure that all of our users are safe and that we're contributing to this ecosystem as fast as we can. So thank you all for your time. Thank you for joining us today. If you have any questions, please, you know, make sure to contact some of our PR reps, and we'll be more than happy to address these for you.
This now concludes our session. Thank you for attending. A recording of this presentation will be made available after the launch. Participants, you may now disconnect.